Hello, everyone. While people are arguing about the toppling of a certain statue of Ras Makwanan in Harar, a city in which my paternal grandmother was raised, there was something more important that happened, and that is the singer of Oromo background, Hachalu Hundessa, was murdered. As of now, we don't know who, what, where, when, why, how. A lot of these things are uncertain. For those of you who are aware of the spook state and its many branches in different countries, you may have different theories as to what happened. And people grieve in different ways. I took to IG earlier today to grieve in the way that I know as an Orthodox Christian, which is to sing Gabiya Nafsiya. Go, O my soul, O my breath of life, unto your place of rest. The Lord has dealt plentifully with you. The Lord is your helper. He saves, he rescues, he delivers my soul or my breath of life from death. That's the way that the Ge'ez Rite tradition deals with death, which we call, you know, falling asleep with the Lord or finding rest. Falling asleep or finding rest. In any event, all I can do is that type of prayer and highlight the Oromo community how I know how. You know, a lot of my family is from Northern Shoa, and so it is inevitable that I have Oromo in me. We don't have all the facts on the ground, but I do believe my paternal great-grandfather is either half or full. And the rest of my family is predominantly Amharic speaking, but even my grandparents on my dad's side were fluent Oromo speakers who grew up in Oromo neighborhoods in Diredawa and in Harar, although they were originally from Munz and Minjar in Northern Shoa. On my other side, like I said, predominantly Amharic speakers, but you find people on the border of Tigray. And so you find a lot of people who speak Tigrinya as well. Really makes my family a quintessential Ethiopian family, a family with people of all types of backgrounds. The book I'm going to review is Oromo Democracy by Asmarom, Legese. Oromo Democracy, Asmarom, Legese. I should probably put a link when this video is up. There's a beautiful map in here that shows you how the Oromo spread from the 1500s onward. Northern kind of cap is Raya, which is the southern part of Tigray. And the southern portion is Orma, which is about in central Kenya. So there's a point on the Kenyan-Ethiopian border, an area known as one of the main areas from which the Oromo spread, called Borana. And in Borana, you find the most conservative Oromo. And what I mean by conservative in this context, traditionalist, whatever term you want to use, is that they are the ones who changed the least, who stayed put, who stayed local, who maintained Wakefana, which is the indigenous Oromo religion, right? The sky god and everything that comes along with it, as opposed to converting to Islam, as opposed to converting to Protestantism, as opposed to converting to Orthodox Christianity, which a lot of other Oromo did. The other Oromo who spread to Raya through Shoa and Gwadjam and Walega to the north and to the south, all throughout Kenya, they lose parts of their identity in different ways by being more liberal, by being more modern, or being more contemporary. And so Asmarom Legese, Professor Asmarom Legese, is an anthropologist of Eritrean background, and he wanted to study Eritrea at first, but he was prevented by the imperial regime in which he was studying in Addis Ababa. There's a lot of backstory to it, and you could hear a lot of his interviews, but he talks about how some of the colonial representation in Eritrea and Asmara at the time prevented him from studying even beyond the fourth grade. So that's how he gets to Addis Ababa, the capital city of Ethiopia, in the first place. But then when he's there, he runs into issues when they're trying to control what he gets to study. He's later sent on to Uganda, partially based off of his will, partially based off of circumstances forced upon him. And eventually he gets the idea, I'm going to study the Oromo people. And in order to study, he studies the Borana, who are the least changed, the most Oromo in the sense of preserving the oldest Oromo traditions. He begins the book by speaking of what he calls Oromo democracy. Democracy is a very debatable word. I know people like my father and other people don't like using this particular word to describe the indigenous form of governance. I first learned about this from Professor Ephraim Misak a number of years ago. He's half Ethiopian Oromo and half Yemeni Jew. He's been in the United States for decades. The really old videos of him teaching at the Ivy Leagues, right? At Princeton and Yale and Harvard. And he's very pan-Ethiopianist minded. He speaks Oromo along with like 17 other Ethiopian languages, and a ton of the Semitic and Cushitic languages are in his purview. And in any event, I heard him speak at my church one time about how the Oromo used to not have prisons, used to not have jails. You know, they would either have indigenous forms of reconciliation through restorative justice, or they would banish you. In this book from Professor Asmarom, I also learned that in some cases they would curse people, and more often than not, people who are cursed ended up dead some way, somehow. There's a little bit of a tongue-in-cheek and a wink going on there, but that's part of the history too. You talk about the warfare. What's interesting about the Oromo governance is that there's a lot of checks and balances. Asmarom does not like this term, checks and balances, because it's distinct from the American system. But the leadership take on various roles. There's a religious, specifically like a religious organization, and there's specifically a secular organization. And they have some lines that are very distinct and some lines that are blurred, but they respect each other. They check each other. And for the most part, which is kind of funny, the head leadership kind of stays away from each other. So it's a little bit of peace through segregation. And they meet every 3 to 8 years on various cycles. The Oromo have their own indigenous calendar. What's typically called the Ethiopian calendar is really the Ge'ez calendar. So you have professionals and experts and specialists who study the Oromo astronomy itself. And you have to know that in order to know, you know, when the next meetings are. And with these great meetings, liberal or conservative, you have all the various dialect speaking, which are intelligible, of the Oromo, as well as the various tribes of various liberalism who come back. And so some of them, although they've adopted, you know, Islam and Christianity, they will have a sort of syncretism where they're still participating in Wake Fana practices, one of the most famous of which, you know, would be Erecha, where there was famously a massacre a couple years ago, right? So anyway, there's a lot of legislation, but for the most part in the history, there's no written language. It's a spoken language. So the legislative action that happens, and this is where a lot of the European colonial anthropologists made mistakes, is they thought because there's no writing, there is no form of legislation. But the legislation and the precedent of the judges that judge in their communities, or arbitrate, if you want to use the word arbitrator instead of judge, under the tree that is a famous symbol, and gather the community, they have to memorize these things. So they have to train. One of the more fascinating things about the Oromo democracy or form of governance is that you don't just wait till you're 35 and, you know, become president. You go through a series of cycles, of periods of leadership where you're tested and trained, and it's like hyper localized. So you serve on some local council for a set Gada cycle, and then you go to another Gada cycle. And over a period of like 12 to 20 years, people are testing you. They're seeing how you are trained, and they're saying, you know, what is it about this person that makes them a good leader? What is it about this person that makes them a meh leader? Or what makes this person a terrible leader? And even if you make it through all those ranks to the top, you can be voted out if you're not doing right. So there are internal systems in which people are getting checked the whole way. there are some famous people in jurisprudence, in Oromo jurisprudence and precedent, who have made some of the most fundamental changes over the centuries to Oromo law. And yet there are one or two things about them which are egregious. And so people work in this liminal space as well, in this gray area where they say, we're able to critique this bad thing that they've done while also commend this good thing that they've done. And we're not presenting them as, you know, pure, innocent saints, but as people who had ups and downs and as complicated figures. I think this was the idea behind the Game of Thrones series, as well as the idea behind The Watchmen, was not having the cookie cutter sort of superheroes and villains that you're typically used to, but painting with a more gray brush across the board to show you how complex human beings are. And finally, the book talks about what could we apply from Oromo institutions in our modern context with everything going on. I think we need to study the Gada, which is that system of Oromo governance, and we need to find out in what ways can we adopt what's going on here. In what ways can we say, like Professor Asmarom suggests towards the end of the book, what forms of systems, checks, and balances are in the Gada that don't exist in the current systems of politics that we're using? In what way can we use, particularly he commends, the blessing system? So whenever there's a lot of crazy beef going on and people are shouting each other, they say, let's take a moment and pause and have kind of a religious moment. The closest thing in contemporary American society would be like these mindfulness checks, but not everybody adopts that type of pattern or has that level of religiosity. So maybe there's a way in respecting the various religions that exist in Ethiopia to present a space of blessing to get rid of kind of strife in the midst of even secular political assemblies. And we saw this kind of alliance recently with Abuna Yosef of the Orthodox Church and the Hajj, the head of the Muslims of Ethiopia, and the various Protestants and Catholics gathered together for a country-wide prayer. So in any event, I recommend that you read and at least think and consider Oromo Democracy by Professor Asmarom Legese, and especially try to understand the various cultures and societies and indigenous wisdom that we have in our Ethiopian society writ large.